Nobody loves a fairy when she's 40. Nobody loves a fairy when she's old. By the face of this magnificent one, too many has appealed. But gone is the illusion once you've had it sold and healed.
Tonight on Emerald City, a look at the camp and wit of Mr. Lynn Carter. Also this evening, Vito Russo talks with Larry Kramer about his seething new novel, Faggots. Good evening. We had to cancel the program originally scheduled for tonight due to technical difficulties. The program in question featured Quentin Crisp, the author of The Naked Civil Servant, and Bishop Robert Clement and Father John Noble of the Church of the Beloved Disciple, New York's first gay church. If possible, that program will be scheduled at a later date. I don't know how many of you are aware of it, but there's an organization here in New York called the Islanders. It's over a decade old, but we just had our first experience with them this past weekend. The Islanders are the group that run charter buses between New York and Fire Island during the summer months, or to Sable. During the winter months, they do the same thing. They run charters, but to other places, you know, ski trips, things like that. This past weekend, we went on one of these trips up to Roxbury Run Village, which is a land development project in the Catskills. Riding on the bus was just like flying first class to Los Angeles. The aisles were actually crowded with people running back and forth with coffee and pastries and Bloody Marys and copies of Bleep magazine. It was really a lot of fun. The Islanders Club is run by Blue Fletrick and Harry Diaz, and if you've never been on one of their trips, I suggest you give them a call. There's nothing else like them. This evening, Vito Russo, who is a regular contributor to this program, will be talking to Larry Kramer. Mr. Kramer is a noted screenwriter who has authored things as memorable as Women in Love and things as forgettable as The Lost Horizon, or the remake. He's just written a new book, which is entitled Faggots. The book is published by Random House and is due to be published nationally as soon as the Briggs Initiative is resolved. As to why this is the case, you'll just have to watch this evening's interview and draw your own conclusions. Mr. Kramer is highly opinionated regarding the subject matter of this book, and as a result speaks rather graphically on occasion. In New York, you'll see this interview intact, but on the West Coast, the necessary deletions have been imposed. Sorry. Coming up a little later this evening from New York's grand finale, Mr. Lynn Carter, 1978. We featured Lynn on this program about a year ago, and at that time I mentioned that he was perhaps one of the best-known female impressionists in the world. Well, he still is, and we'll be showing you some highlights of his new show a little later on tonight's program. An interesting show. We'll be right back with Larry Kramer after this. Don't move.
Jan Wallmans, 28 Cornelia Street, becoming a legend in the village.
If you like the island, you'll love the village. Roxbury Run Village near Woodstock, New York. It's a Fire Island sort of ambiance with privacy only hundreds of acres can provide. Your townhouse has an oversized scenic deck, a fireplace of native stone, wood-beam cathedral ceilings, a kitchen built for party givers. Roxbury Run Village, where you can enjoy your summer freedoms all year long. 80% mortgages for financially qualified buyers. Call 914-357-6408. If you like the island, you'll love the village.
Welcome back. I'm Vito Russo, and my guest this evening on Emerald City is Larry Kramer, the author of Faggots, a controversial new novel, which will be out in November from Random House. Welcome, Larry.
Hi, Vito.
Like to talk to you first about your concept for this book. It's a very controversial book. It's a very explicitly sexual book. It's a very funny book about gay life and the search for gay love. Why don't you tell me a little bit about how you got interested in writing this book, why you wrote it?
Let me ask you a question. Why did you think it was controversial?
I think it's controversial because it talks about all the things. I have a theory about gay life and the way gay life presents itself to the so-called general public, and that's that we never let them know what really goes on during the night times that they don't see at places we create for ourselves.
Which means that you're a little ashamed of what you're doing.
Exactly. Right. And this book sort of illuminates that whole world that gay liberationists always say, well, we don't talk about that in public. Mm-hmm. We don't tell those people about that.
And well, I guess I think it would be a symbol of our maturity when we were free to talk about everything like everybody else does.
You have decided, for the purposes of faggots, to create a character who I assume is yourself, Fred Lemish,
yes.
Who is on a quest to find love before he's 40.
Right. I'm 43.
Well,
that's why, why I wrote the novel, is that I had been a fairly successful screenwriter, and I decided that movies weren't for me. For various reasons. In the end, you can't really write about the things that are meaningful to you. And I also looked at myself and looked at my life, and there I was, 40 years old, and or approaching it, and why hadn't I fallen in love? Why did I see so little love around me? Why did I see so few relationships that were either visible or working or represented what I thought that I wanted? Was it all of this my fault? Was it the world's fault? What did homosexuality mean to me? It was an exploration of me and the gay world as I saw it, or as I was trying to see it, and it became that kind of an odyssey to see. I found out I really didn't know that much about it, or I hadn't faced up to thinking of. I had been doing a lot of things that I hadn't been thinking about. The more I investigated, the more I got angry, although the novel is a comic novel, and I'm happy to hear you say that you laughed out loud a lot of places.
Yeah, I sure did.
It's also, underneath it all, a very angry novel, and I think that what's being manifested now in this pre-publication period are some very evident instances of people being angry at my being angry, for the reasons you say. How dare I talk about the bars or Fire Island, or the meat racks, or fist fucking, or can I say that on television?
Sure.
Yeah. All of the things that a lot of us at one time or another, if not do, at least witness, or talk about, or think about.
And, well, where does your, when we say that this, that Faggots is a very angry book, the anger comes from your own reaction to your own community. So who are you angry at? Are you angry at ourselves for the way we treat ourselves and each other, or at society for placing us in the kind of underground where that becomes possible?
No, you hit on a very good point. I'm angry at myself. I'm angry, very angry at all of my friends. I'm angry at this community. I am not angry at the world, and I think that this is, I think we've done everything to ourselves. I'm tired of the excuse, oh, it's the world's fault. They don't want us, God doesn't want us, the Catholic Church doesn't want us, the Orthodox Judaism doesn't want us, my mommy and daddy don't want me. Fuck it, it's time to stop all of that. It's time to stop making excuses. Look at yourself. You have to like yourself a lot. It is very difficult to like yourself in the face of all of this antagonism from everyone else. However, that is no reason to place ourselves further and further into a ghetto, into a dead-end ghetto of fucking on the streets and Christopher Street and the mine shaft and Fire Island and drugs.
In all of this, this is fascinating to me too, because we all sit around with our friends on Fire Island in the Pines or in the Grove or on Christopher Street and talk about these things, but we never really quite talk about them. We talk about them endlessly,
exactly.
But we never say anything about the quality of our lives as lived out on the streets and in the bars and in the parks.
Well, that's what I tried to write about.
And I think, yes, to a certain extent, you're yelling at those people, you fools, you really haven't really talked about this to each other. And the quality of the friendships in this book, there are a lot of friendships in this book. Fred Lemish's friends are numerous and diverse people from all different walks of gay life. but who all have this sort of non-communication in common. They love each other. There's love there between Fred and his best friend Anthony, between Fred and his friends Laverne, Maxine, and Patty. There's a lot of love going on, but there's not a lot of real truth in their communication. And is that, I always find that when I try to talk, for instance, especially to people, I hate to generalize and say to the people on Fire Island, but you're sitting out on Fire Island and everybody's having a blue whale, and you suddenly say, why do we fuck in the bushes at night? And everybody says, how dare you mention that? Mm. You know? And a lot of the anger that comes from the book, I think, is directed at that lack of communication. Gay people don't talk about these things.
Well, I guess that's the anger at not trying to do more with our lives. I think a lot of the criticism that's being leveled at me now is, how dare I expose all of this at this very tender moment in the cause of gay liberation, when you're not allowed to say anything for fear it'll be ammunition for Anita Bryant and Briggs and all these other people. And I'm saying we have to put our own house in order.
Well, this comes with a lot of frustration in your life. You wrote the screenplay for Ken Russell's Women in Love.
Right.
And we were talking a little while ago about a lot of your disillusionment with writing not what you felt, or at least sitting in Hollywood and looking forward to writing revised versions of what you really felt.
Right.
Instead of
right.
bringing out what, you know, the real issues of your life,
right.
which I think these are.
Well, we have no responsibilities. Why are we making such a big deal about being mature people and living in the world? Why are we making such a big deal about telling our parents, coming out, being in the closet?
Because we're really ashamed of the way we live.
Well, it's time to stop all of that.
Well,
it's
then
not
what about
easy. No one said it was easy. But we don't have families to support. We don't have children's dentist bills to pay. We don't have responsibilities. I think it's in the nature of everyone to want to be in love. I think an awful lot of my friends want to be in love. Why are so few of them in love? Why do these relationships disintegrate after 6 months or a year, myself included, into either ex-friends, enemies,
threesomes,
friendships? Why can't you go on and build a life together as a solid member of community, doing something, contributing to that world?
Do you suppose it has something to do with the quality of the ghetto? It seems to me that anybody who travels around this country and looks at gay people in various cities and towns, you come to the conclusion that it's easier to be with a lover in a small town in Indiana than it is to find a lover and stay with a lover in the ghetto in New York or in LA or in San Francisco.
Well, that often is a relationship for the other extreme, which is that there isn't anything else, and that's also just as weak and lack of courage. I mean, that's desperation. I think ghettos are dangerous, not dangerous, are dead ends for any group of people, be they Jews or blacks or prostitutes or whatever. I mean, I think we're all together in this world and we all have to fight for our space and be proud of our space and help make the world go. It's up to everybody to have responsibility, to be his own leader, to have a certain morality. There's a complete, utter lack of morality, I think, in the gay world right now, because for some reason, I think, because it's this determination to carve out what we're calling a new lifestyle, which, for as far as I can see, the only thing about it is that it's different from the straight lifestyle. We're going to go ass over backwards to be different, just because we don't want to be like them. But we're all the same. I don't see what fucking in the back room of the anvil gets you.
What about the people who choose that lifestyle? People who choose promiscuity, who choose non-monogamous relationships. There are people who view promiscuity as a positive thing, who choose not to be faithful or monogamous in their relationships with other people.
I do not see promiscuity as positive, but leaving that aside, look, people can do whatever they want. They just don't have the right then to say it should have been better, because they haven't done a fucking thing to make it better.
Right.
They can't wake up at 60 years old and say, oh, poor me, why have I never fallen in love? Why do I not have anything now except a lot of broken memories? Fuck it. You made your bed, you laid in it, in the mud of Fire Island, in the meat rack, you got what you deserve. Life isn't easy. Responsibilities aren't easy. Building a life together isn't easy. The rewards, I think, are great if you're willing to go beyond
That vision.
Yeah. Yes, if you're going to be beyond the orgasm, you know, beyond the quick trick. Life is about sharing and company and shared pleasures and shorthand that people can talk and right. and cuddling in bed and doing things and building a house and building a life and being a proud part of a community where you're not ashamed to hold your lover's hand when you walk down the street in public, when you can kiss, when you can be free to be what you are naturally. I don't think that the sexual dead end leads to any of those things. I think it just pushes us further and further into feeling terrible about yourself. How can you feel good about yourself as a person after you've been pissed on in a bathtub? I mean, you laugh, all right, that's an extreme, but we all know it.
That's right. Well, those of you who see faggots will find a lot of hilarious humor in it. A lot
you
of
never know from this conversation.
A lot of the anger that Larry Kramer has been talking about here tonight. You might hate it and you might love it, but you will have to read this book. It's extraordinary, and it'll be out in November. We'll be right back from the Emerald City. Thank you, Larry Kramer.
Thank you, Vito.
Hi, I'm Arthur Bell, and this is my office. It stinks. This is my new book. It's called Kings Don't Mean a Thing. It's a story about a newspaper heir and a hustler, both murdered, and a reporter. Guess who's a reporter? Kings Don't Mean a Thing, the John Knight murder case, and it's terrific.
Kings Don't Mean a Thing. It's as if Truman Capote had put himself into In Cold Blood.
Typically English summer, she takes typically English trips.
From New York's grand finale, it's Lynn Carter and company.
And if anyone asks her how she likes this typically English life, Hermione Gingold's never been so Pygmalion born.
Thank you very much. You know, when I first came to the United States, I came over here on one of the queens, page one. I think it was Mary, page 10. I play typically English matrons with each typically English part, with a typically English tongue inside my cheek. Oh, I enjoyed my role in Gigi for its typically English score.
Your dress was blue.
It was beige.
You were 32.
That's my age. Oh, yes, I remember it well. I learned it in a typically English week. Last year I was typically English working, filming another typically English fop a flop. Liz and I played typically English cricket,
while the rest of the cast was busted by the cops.
Right on.
She has typically English manners and a typically English flat in the real American city of New York.
And if anyone asks me how I like this real American life, I will always be a Yankee Doodle.
She's a Yankee Doodle dandy, a Yankee Doodle.
Thank you so much. They're droopy, but they're clean, dear. For years a fairy queen I've been. For years I foiled a demon king. But alas, I'm getting on. The years have flown somehow. And I feel the fairy snowdrop. That's a fudgicle, dear. Years unwanted now. For years I reigned in Fairy Dell. I waved my wand and I waved it well. If I can't do all I did, I'm satisfied, because I'd sooner be a husband. Well, then I... Then I... What an ugly bitch. Then I would... Then I would... Ah! Then I would... My God. Then I would... I know, I've got it, don't worry. Then I would... I never was. I don't like your attitude, Brezhnikov. Now there's a turning point for you. Take five, dear. Oh, shit. Nobody loves a fairy when she's 40. Nobody loves a fairy when she's old. By the face of this magnificent one, too many has appealed. But gone is the illusion once you've had it sold and healed.
Tallulah Bankhead!
What's happening in this nation with the younger generation? My God, they keep looking for new sensations every day. Why, even kids who come from good stock flip their lids up there in, my God, I played stock there with Fred Keating and Alice Pierce. It's a very theatrical group, darling. Oh, Woodstock, darling. As for me, I'll take the good old-fashioned way. Don't get bitchy, Buster. I'll put you back on a zither before you'll know what hit you. Besides, this mic is flat. Some chicks just get their kicks, darling, when they're on pot and psychedelics. They think we who are not involved with pot are ancient relics. Why, to seduce a rich recluse in some motel along the highway. I must tell you about that, darling. A few years ago, I was speeding down the highway in this adorable little Porsche with a humpy little number behind the wheel, little piece of trade, and page 18. Not foreign, domestic. Anyway, and he said to me, Tallulah, I've heard some wild things about you. I said, you've heard nothing, darling. I can tell you things nobody knows. He said, well, I'd like to hear it. I said, well, I'm a witch. He said, a what? I said, a witch. He said, which what? I said, a witch. Not what. Watch the mouth. They form the words when I speak. I am a witch. I can turn you into anything I want to turn you into. He said, well, I'd like to see you do it. So I whispered in his ear. He turned into a motel. We go all over. He took me to a gay wedding 2 weeks ago. It was wild. The bride and groom wore naga hide. They weren't into the full leather kit yet, you see. Ah! And they were married under a hoopah of tires. Firestones. Oh, I tell you, it was wild. And for the ceremony, they recited the Honda warranty. Isn't that butch? Page 19. They exchanged rings that were about this big around. I don't know how they stayed on the finger. Then they jumped on their little Hondas and off they went into the sunset. I caught the bridal bouquet. It was a jock strap. Oh, I had it bronzed. We serve onion dip in it now. It holds a gallon and a half. Oh, she was a big mother, I'll tell you. I was absolutely appalled when I spoke to some of the leading stars to find out they're not only being produced and directed, but managed by their own hairdressers. My God, Warren Beatty certainly started something with that little blower of his, didn't he? And they said, Betty. I don't know why they said that. I know my name. They said, Betty, you cannot go on tour without your own hairdresser. He can be of invaluable service to you in so many ways. I got the message. The next day, I was off to the golden ghetto of Hollywood, Beverly Hills. I walked into the leading hairdressing salon and went right to the reception desk. The girl looked at me and said, yes, and I said, yes. She said, you've an appointment? I said, yes. She said, yes. I said, deja vu. She said, your name. I said, let's try Davis. She said, would that be Mac? How easy they forget. It's difficult to be a star who still cannot pronounce an R, but I'll proceed to make my loot standing in my rubber suit across your hot bra. That's for me. It'll put things back to where they used to be. Now that I admit to 70, so what? I am 70. And where have all the flowers gone?
Special thanks this evening to Fred Grades and Walter Kent. This tape was edited at Vertical Interval Limited in New York. Good night.